Welcome to the My Crazy Office Podcast with the authors of Working With You Is Killing Me, Working For You Isn't Working For Me, and Mean Girls at Work, Kathy Elster and Katherine Crowley. They are committed to helping you navigate the hardest part of any job, the people. And now, here are Kathy and Katherine.
Hey everyone, I'm Kathy Elster.
And I'm Katherine Crowley, and welcome to My Crazy Office.
And today we want to welcome our guest back. You've been here before, playwright and Emmy Award-winning TV writer Matt Hoverman.
See what happens when you do this podcast? You win an award almost immediately.
Yeah, and thank you for giving it to us.
Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome. The fact that it's 6 inches and made of chocolate shouldn't just make you think that it's not the real Emmy in any way.
Oh, boy. So how can people find out about you?
Well, there's this thing called the internet.
Oh, yeah.
And I would suggest going on it and going to matthoverman.com, M-A-T-T-H-O-V as in Victor, E-R-M-A-N.com.
And that'll get good. You there. All right, good. So how have you been feeling since you won an Emmy? Like, I mean, how do you feel different?
Well, none of my clothes fit me because I'm taller.
Since you won.
Yeah, since I won, I'm much faster at the gym on the treadmill. Yeah.
Oh, well, that's a good.
No, I'm feeling really good actually. It's it definitely people have noticed. It's put a little bounce in my step.
Sure. Yeah.
Well, we know that it was well earned and hard work.
Thank you. You know what's really hard work is that I actually wear it around a chain on my neck.
it's about
40
treadmill.
Pounds. Yeah, right.
On
the treadmill. Still though, I'm faster.
Did you want to carry it around?
I really did. Yeah. I really did. I'll tell you an interesting fact, though. The minute you get it, they warn you not to hold it by the waist, which, of course, is where everybody holds it.
Yeah.
Because the grease and acid or whatever from your hand corrodes it, and then it snaps in half.
Ooh.
So you're actually supposed to carry it from the bottom. And here's the other thing that it says on the bottom. You can't sell your Emmy.
Of course.
No, you have to. If they discover that you've sold the Emmy, they will take possession of it and keep it in your honor. At the Emmy vault or wherever it is they keep the Emmys.
Wow. So what happens if someone dies? Do they bury the Emmy with them?
It becomes your headstone.
Or it goes in the casket.
Or it goes in the casket. Instead of me, yeah. You can pass it down.
So
you can inherit an Emmy, but you can't purchase an Emmy.
Okay, well, thank you so much information in so little
time.
Yeah,
because so many of us need to know what to do with our Emmys. All right, let's just go to our first question, Logan.
I recently got hired as the executive assistant to the senior partner of a high-profile firm. My new boss is great, but I'm discovering that my predecessor, the previous executive assistant, was totally incompetent. During the half day of training that she gave me, she admitted that she sometimes had trouble keeping track of everything. That was the understatement of the year. Now I'm frantically trying to learn a really difficult job while dealing with someone else's chaotic files, incomplete contracts, unread documents, and overall mess. While my boss understands what's going on, the people around me in finance and other departments seem really impatient and angry with me for her mistakes. How do I handle this without blaming the former assistant for everything?
The Obama dilemma.
Yeah, exactly. Every president deals with this. I think that her boss should hire a professional organizer.
Oh, my goodness.
To come in and clean up the mess.
That's a thing?
Yes, there's a whole organization. Oh, yeah. We used to lecture for them, National Association of Professional Organizers.
So you would propose that this employee ask the boss for a professional organizer to clean up the
predecessor's
mess?
I do, because I think, you know, her job probably is not to take a mess and organize it. It's just to do the job. Uh-huh. And it's very difficult to clean up somebody else's mess because it's based on their thinking.
Yeah.
Whereas a professional comes in and they know how to do that.
I think that's a great and lofty idea, and I don't know how many bosses would be willing to do that for their employee. So I would say, yes, definitely you could weigh in for that, but I would say that what the boss could definitely do is do a little front-running for you with these other departments to explain that you are cleaning up the mess that was left behind.
Wow.
Yeah.
Those are both really positive suggestions. Those are so hopeful.
Oh, okay, Matt, where were you going to go?
Well, I know.
He was going to go in a darker direction.
No, I just feel, I think I can see this. I guess the key here is my boss understands what's going on. Because I can imagine a version of this where the boss just expects you to do magic overnight.
And
suck it up.
Work it out.
And I don't see that boss hiring a front running or hiring someone to help. I mean, you know, could you ask for overtime to come in for a few weekends and, you know, straighten up yourself and make it a system that works for you? What do you think of that idea?
Oh, yeah, I think you could do that. Well, the idea is to just, you know, tell the boss you need more help.
Right.
Any way you can do it. Right. Maybe, you know, someone else in the company who understands the systems can help. But my other suggestion is that you buy everybody pizza.
Yes.
I think the food works.
And make sure the invitation is really well organized and clear.
Yeah, exactly. let them know you're not the problem. I mean, it could be chocolate.
And you're not the pizza.
Right.
You're not inviting them for something else.
But just that you're not the problem and that you want them to like you.
Okay.
And that you're going to solve this. But in the meantime, here's some...
some food to shut you up.
Right. I care about you, food.
That's not a bad idea. I think the big thing for the individual, though, is that the tendency when you come into a new job is that you feel as if you do have to solve it, right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
So
you have to already have solved it.
Yeah, you've already screwed up and you already have to solve it and you've got to learn stuff you don't even know yet and it's a faulty, faulty system. So I would say for the individual to understand that, first of all, you're not the first one who's come into this kind of situation, and second, that you need to pace yourself. And third, then think strategically, these wonderful ideas like getting everyone pizza or asking the boss for help or whatever the case may be, even have individual discussions with the different departments, but to understand that it isn't your fault, even though you may feel that way because you probably feel like you should know it all already.
See, I think it's really difficult to organize somebody else's work. First of all, to organize someone else's work is to get in their head. That's gross to begin with.
Right.
But then the other part is you don't know the company yet. You don't really know the system.
You don't.
So to walk into a mess like that, I really think the company owes her some help.
Yeah, I think it's so telling that she had a half a day of training with this person.
Probably better.
I know. And that, I mean, this is, I guess what I would build on both of your points, which is that clearly it's not, while you may feel responsible for it,
yeah.
and that you're the one screwing up.
Yeah.
Clearly this has been going on for a long time.
That's right.
That this is, they're not, while they may be upset with you, it's not like this other assistant was getting it done.
Right.
Doesn't sound like. So.
No, it's right.
I think it's important to understand that you can't fix Rome in a day.
Well, that your boss built Rome
inadvertently,
right?
Right?
He put up with this incompetent person for quite some time.
Right.
And now you're paying for it.
Yeah, I think they have to help. The boss has to help.
And while it might be difficult to clean up somebody else's mess, you have to be involved in it because you are not, it's not like you're temping. You have to make that mess work for you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right.
There are people who love systems. I actually have a client who's in a very, very similar situation, and she prides herself on creating beautiful systems.
Mm.
It's just that she just keeps getting hit by these bombshells of things she didn't know the other person didn't do, and then feeling like she did something terribly wrong.
Yeah.
What's a realistic expectation for having your new system in place time-wise when you say pace yourself? Would you say a year?
Well, it takes 3 months to learn any job.
Yeah.
And then, I mean, I would just say...
6 months?
Knowing my wife is a personal assistant, I know that, like, there's things that happen over the course of a year that can surprise you. By the time next year comes around, you can anticipate, but...
Yeah, so it's a good year.
And the good news is you have a nice boss, so you will be forgiven for even your mistakes, probably, this other person, your predecessor was.
I think with cupcakes, maybe.
You're escalating.
Well, I really...
Coffee.
Fruit salad and a watermelon is always a wower.
Yeah, I do think that...
Personal
food.
Massage.
Right. Well, that's good. But food works in an office.
Yeah.
You know, it definitely speaks.
So you're saying something interesting, which is to basically bring everyone in to be interested in helping you by offering a sign of peace, which comes in the form of food.
Right.
Interesting.
And maybe even prefacing things. Instead of blaming the previous assistant, prefacing things with, you know, we're doing a whole... remodeling of the way we do things here. Mm-hmm. So if you can help me with, you know, like, yeah. I'd like to improve flow as I'm coming in.
Yeah.
Sort of setting it up that way as you begin the conversations.
We just turned you positive, didn't we?
Despite myself.
But I like that. To talk about what you're building rather than blaming your predecessor, which I think actually can be a real problem because then you're seen as a whiner.
Yeah.
Yeah.
As true as it may be.
And a complainer. Right. And she may be beloved. She may be disorganized, but people
she
may
have
like
brought
her.
Many true. Cupcakes. True. Maybe she brought donuts.
I'm
you
sure
never
she did.
But find somebody to vent to, right?
Yes, you need one safe haven. There's someone who knows. And actually the boss probably knows.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
That's it.
Okay, I'm getting stressed. Let's move on to the next question. Very stressful.
Hang in there. You're doing a great job, we're sure.
I went on vacation last week and ran into a real problem. My boss, who I believe is a certified workaholic, emailed and texted me every day, even on the weekends. He had 100 questions and kept writing, "Sorry to bother you, but this is important." My family yelled at me for always being on my phone while we were on the beach, and I was exhausted when I returned to work. I have another week off scheduled for August, but I can't feel rested if I'm holding my boss's hand the whole time. Help.
Oh. Yeah, okay. So the next vacation you have to, I would go to the boss and say that you're going to a remote location
with no phone
with very little reception service.
Exactly.
And then I would organize somebody else in the company who's willing to hold the boss's hand for that week.
I'm with you exactly.
And again, cupcakes, something. You know, I would think give that person something.
You have to find a mini you because this person is too anxious to be left on his or her own, cannot handle it. The workaholic. Mm-hmm. But I also would just want to say my heart is breaking for you and for all those who lose their vacation to workplace emails and texts. That's just so tough because it's so hard when you're in it to know that you have the right not to respond.
Yeah, and you have the right to go on vacation and disconnect.
Right. Yeah.
Really disconnect, especially a week. That's not good. No one is going to go out of business in a week.
You know what I see with people I know is there are expectations from the boss, but there's your own internal expectation.
That's right, exactly.
And I feel like this person might be struggling some with her own. You know, she's perhaps, or he's keeping this, enabling this situation to happen by responding, by feeling over-responsible.
Yes. Oh, Matt.
Very
so
good.
So perceptive.
Very good.
It's so accurate. And actually, I think even you could not just feel responsible, you may feel competitive. So in other words...
threatened if somebody else can do what you do.
Exactly. Yeah. That if you don't respond to everything, that you won't be valuable enough to this person. Mm. And workaholics are often competitive in a passive-aggressive way. You know, so the boss may be testing you to see, do you have the stuff it takes to really commit to this job or, you know, whatever. There may be tacit messages that are being sent along with the
text. Oh, there probably are.
That's a loaded gun.
I use that.
Yeah, better than an Emmy.
I used to temp, and this one job I had was working in the evening for a lawyer because they like to have round-the-clock support for him in case he was there. And his daytime assistant would give me nothing to do because she was so afraid I would do it better.
Yes.
Which was a great gig for me, but I'm sure exhausted her.
Yeah, that's such a good point.
And it's hard sometimes to trust that somebody else will do it, and maybe they won't do it quite as well as you, but it'll get done.
Right.
And everybody has their own way of doing things, their own system.
You do.
Yeah, that the other person isn't going to do it the way you
right,
would
exactly.
do it.
Right,
right.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah, yeah.
Right.
Well, it's taking a risk, actually, to set a boundary and to go and say, I'm going to a remote place and find a mini you. All of that is taking a risk and trusting that if you take care of yourself, you'll still have your job when you come back from vacation.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, I've never heard of a situation where somebody did that. They disconnected and then lost their job after a week. No.
No.
It doesn't happen. And a week goes so fast.
Yeah. The other thing that's interesting is sometimes when you model healthier behavior, the boss or whoever the individual is will do the same, may parrot that, you know. Again, even possibly in a competitive way. Well, you took your vacation, so I'm taking mine. You know, that kind of thing, which could be good for you.
Which means sometimes braving their upsetness, their original being upset, right? But then later they come back and say, you know, I was upset because I realized I do the same thing. And maybe maybe I'll really disconnect.
So be careful when you say you're going to a remote location because they may, you know, They may
buy
ask
you a phone.
Where are you going? Yeah,
if you say so, that, be careful about posting on Facebook because often the location of your photo comes up, and if it says the mall.
Right. So you know, you have to, you know. So that's if you want to do it that way. Another way is to say, I really need to disconnect.
Yeah.
So I'm not going away, but I need to totally disconnect. So I found so-and-so who's going to help you out.
Yeah.
I mean, at some point, you know, that's what you have to do for yourself.
And also, then not answer.
Then you're right.
Yeah, well, that's hard.
You cannot take
challenge.
The bait. That is exactly right.
Because they will test that boundary.
They will. Whenever you set a boundary, someone's going to test it. That's such a good point. And the other thing that you could do if you just absolutely desperately or don't think it can happen, I have a business owner friend who just went away to a remote location, and her policy was she checked first thing in the morning at 3 o'clock and at 6, and that was it.
How remote?
Canada.
Oh.
I mean, not like you can't, she couldn't speak on the phone for very long for some reason. I guess, it was like a remote lake.
Uh-huh. Sounds good.
Still sound good.
The satellite only passes over for 12 minutes a day.
Exactly. All right. So set a boundary. We encourage you to set a boundary. Find a mini you.
Yeah.
Take the risk of taking care of yourself.
Yeah.
Buy cupcakes.
I mean,
bring back something nice.
Bring back
some food item that
and
you can
arrested
share.
You will be a wonderful you for that's, the company.
That's right. Yeah. So that's it for this segment. Matt, where can people find you again? Your website?
MattHoverman.com.
And
yay.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you
my
so
pleasure.
Much.
Thanks for asking me back.
You're welcome.
Do I win an Oscar next time?
Maybe.
We'll see.
And join us next time for another My Crazy Office podcast. And please don't forget to send your questions and your stories to info@mycrazyoffice.co.
Join us next time for another My Crazy Office podcast. And don't forget to send your questions to info@mycrazyoffice.co.